Thank you for making me part of this program. I'll be speaking about management of Amblyopia, the changing perspective, what we were doing earlier, and what are the practices nowadays. So to begin with, the definition of Amblyopia still remains the same. It's unilateral or bilateral decrease of vision, either due to abnormal binocular interaction or due to a pattern deprivation. It is reversible if treated early, but one has to rule out all other causes of poor vision in a child. So as we all know, amblyopia can be classified as strabismic amblyopia, where it is more commonly associated with esotropia as compared to exotropia. Ametropic amblyopia, which is due to high refractive error in both the errors. So it's a bilateral amblyopia because of the visual deprivation in both the eyes. An isometropic amblyopia, when it occurs when there is high refractive error in one eye, while the other eye is either is emetropic or has a very small refractive error. So that's an isometropic amblyopia. Visual deprivation amblyopia is because of any media problem. It could be corneal opacity, it could be congenital cataract, it could be congenital ptosis and other things which can cause which can prevent eye to get stimulated. So management amblyopia, early identification, evaluation, proper evaluation, and appropriate intervention still remains the key for managing amblyopia. What has changed is the concept of cortical plasticity. Earlier, we used to believe that the cortical plasticity is over by age of 7 to 8 years. But nowadays, we have started believing that it still exists even in older age. So even if we do not, if we treat patients who are more than 7 years, or sometimes maybe older as 20 years, there is a possibility that we may be able to restore vision. So one has to keep in mind that this concept of plasticity has changed. We now treat patients as and when comes, especially if it's an anisometropic amblyopia. So in older age group also, it has shown good results. So the basic concept still remains the same: identify the cause, correct the refractive error, and preferential stimulation of amblyopic eye. So we still need to give amblyopic eye some edge over the normal eye so that eye gets stimulated. What has changed is the goal was to achieve an equal vision in both the eyes. Nowadays, the goal is to achieve the binocular vision. We have to restore the binocularity. So that's one change that we are looking for now. And in management amblyopia, the basic methodology, the basic means still remain the same. The optical correction, occlusion therapy is still the mainstay of management, penalization, active vision therapy, and pharmacotherapy. But people are more and more now giving importance to active vision therapy. How can we do that? We'll come to it later on in this presentation. So the optical correction still remains the best stimulant for eye to gain vision. So age-appropriate cycloplegic refraction can never be underestimated. A proper prescription, whether you want to give a full cycloplegic correction or bifocals or an optimal correction, all that has to be kept in mind when we are deciding prescription for these patients. In bilateral refractive errors or in ametropic amblyopia, it's the single most treatment that you can provide. In anisometropic amblyopes have also been shown to improve vision even with optical treatment alone. So around 20-25% patients will show improvement even if you don't give them patching. So it's a very, very important thing that we give them a proper refractive correction. These are the guidelines given by AAO in 2017, and they very well have described how to prescribe glasses and when to prescribe glasses. We now have our own consensus guidelines given by Pediatric Ophthalmology Expert Group. It is published in Indian Journal of Ophthalmology recently. Occlusion therapy still remains the gold standard. What has changed was then, it was a full-time occlusion therapy, but now most of us have shifted to a part-time occlusion therapy because of pedic studies. Various pedic studies have shown that part-time occlusion, which is around 6 hours in a day, are as good as full-time occlusion for moderate to mild kind of an amblyopia. However, one has to understand that maintenance of occlusion is very important. If you suddenly stop the occlusion, the chances of recurrence are very, very high. In a study done from our center, we have shown almost 13% of patients will have recurrence. So it's important that you taper the occlusion gradually from 6 hours, make it to 4 hours, then 2 hours, rather than abruptly stopping it. The third important thing that has to, by which you can correct amblyopia is penalization. It could be an optical penalization with overcorrecting plus glasses, or a pharmacological penalization, again shown by PEDIC studies that atropine is as good as part-time occlusion in moderate amblyopias. Active vision therapy is coming up in big way. And earlier, it was active vision therapy in form of near vision task, pleoptics, or CAM. Nowadays, it's all about software programs and binocular stimulation. So the idea is to provide binocular stimulation in both the eyes to restore the binocularity. The active vision therapy is basically re-education of amblyopic pathway by intense sensory and motor interaction. So video games provide a very playful method. Child is more interested. It engages a child, so they are more compliant. So all these things are coming up with the development of the software, the various apps that have helped in binocular interaction. So there can be monocular video games, dioptric therapy, or therapies that improve stereo acuity. So this was a study published from our center where we had evaluated the role of monocular video game in adjuvant occlusion therapy in management of N-isometropic amblyopia. And this is what we found, that these video games enhance the visual recovery in N-isometropic amblyopia, provided they're given in conjunction with the occlusion and not alone. The other active vision therapy is giving dioptics, which is binocular stimulation of the eyes, and each eye is presented with a different image, and brain is forced to integrate those images into a single image. So it improves the binocular interaction, and in this case, the signal strength coming to the good eye is reduced, so that the amblyopic eye takes over the precedence. The viewing conditions are changed, and the images seen by the good eye is suppressed until both the eyes see approximately the same image. So this study was recently concluded in our center, where we compared two groups. So one group had 30 children, in which we gave this Tetris game available online and on Android platform, and the other children were using part-time occlusion. So BCVA in both the group improved significantly at 3 months, while it was the final visual acuity was also comparable. While if you can see that the near stereo acuity had more improvement in the game group, the contrast sensitivity was also better in the game group. However, the thing that has to be kept in mind, that children with less than 10 years of age were compliant with occlusion, and while the older children were more compliant with the game group. Maybe because of their attention problem or other things, but the younger children were more compliant with occlusion. So to conclude, the basic principle of amblyopia still remains the same. Give the maximum stimulation by proper optical correction. Give the amblyopic eye an edge, either by occlusion or by providing the dioptic stimulation, and regular follow-up and reassessment is necessary. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Swati. That was very nicely given an overview of the scene of amblyopia therapy. Now I'll request Dr. Suma Ganesh.